I went by to Mull Mill, the village of my dream. Back to where my heart still lingers, despite the miles between. Back to where my thoughts return a million times a day. Back to where I spent my youth, where my memories stray. Back to see the village pump that brought the spring into our home. Back to see the chestnut tree with its mighty sheltering dome. Back to see the village hall where we held the fourpenny hops. Back to see the white road, the red road, and the shawl. Back to see the building where we learned our trade. Back to see the factory that made the finest shoes. Back to see the waterway that was cut from Amy Lock. And the sluice that turned the water when the mill was on a break. I remember the village forge, I can hear the anvil ring. Across from the village hall, where stars came to sing. I remember the McKenna's who owned the local store. The Andes and the Grimleys, each side of McKenna's door. Let's go back to Mull Mill, the village of my dream. Back to where my heart still lingers, despite the miles between. Back to where my thoughts return a million times a day. Back to where I spent my youth, to where my memories stray. The factory's not as busy making shoes and boots. And the village of my dreams, it's a cane at the root. But I believe Mickey Briney can turn back the clock and resurrect the village we call the mill. Let's go back to Mull Mill, the village of my dream. Back to where my heart still lingers, despite the miles between. Back to where my thoughts return a million times a day. Back to where I spent my youth, to where my memories stray. Back to where I spent my youth, to where my memories stray.
Mullan is a picturesque 19th century mill village, located 8 miles north of Monaghan town, a few miles to the northeast of Emmyvale and close to the Tyrone border. It is built in the tradition of other Ulster mill villages, similar to, but smaller than, Sion Mills in County Tyrone, Bessbrook in County Armagh, and Drumness in County Down. Although small, the unique aspect of Mullan is that it remains practically unchanged today. Architecturally, much of the village is early Victorian in character. Very few similarly well-defined and preserved examples of early rural industrial development exist in this country. There are also a number of very attractive small cultural and heritage features within the village which make it attractive to visitors. These include a curved stone bench, a working water pump, and a mill race which is reputed to be the longest mill race in the country. It commences just west of the bridge at Emmy Vale, where part of the Mountain Water River is diverted to feed into and raise the water level of Emmy Law. This in turn provided a reliable source of water to power two mills, Corrigan's Mill and Mullan Mill. Mullan, or Willon as Gaeliga, means the mill. McCutcheon in his The Industrial Archaeology of Northern Ireland, 1984, describes these Ulster mill settlements thus. In country areas, the mill village was a compact cluster of regular terraced housing. The character of these industrial settlements reflected the nature and outlook of the proprietors, who had usually built or financed both the houses themselves and the associated range of public buildings, which together made up the physical fabric of the village. Favourable conditions, such as the construction of roads and canals, enabled goods to be transported from remote locations such as Mullan. The Great Northern Railway, the Ulster Canal, and the main Inniskillen to Belfast Road passed close to Mullan. Mullan Mill itself was originally a flax mill and is built around our central courtyard. Its chimney, which was 70 to 80 feet high, has been demolished and the bell has been removed from the belfry for safety reasons. Most of the houses in the village are in two terraces, both facing south, known as the Red Row and the White Row.
Mulligan's, Sherlock's.
Frank's.
Frank's, yeah.
Hamilton's.
This was Hamilton's.
Doran's. Who lived in the next then? Vinci McQuaid.
Yeah.
And then Pat McLonagh and Sally lived the next one. Mm-hmm. Mary Jane Sherry. Yeah. And Alice Scare's mother.
Alice was the last one.
Yeah, Alice was the last one, yeah.
How many of your family lived in the house?
Nine, and my father and mother. 11 people altogether. There was Mick and Ned McKenna and Paddy Hamilton. And they used to come to our house every night in the week. And they'd be sitting up there telling lies to a band playing. And they'd be telling ghost stories. And you'd be going up to go to bed and you'd get to the top of the stairs. No electric light that time. There'd be a candle or a light, and you'd be looking to see was anything under the bed. And you see there's nothing, you take a race across the room and jump up into the bed. See if somebody catch you by the leg. And they wouldn't know the truth about anything. They told the PC one night, but they got an awful shelling from the Germans one day. And when it quieted down that evening, some of the boys put up their head to look around to see what they could see. And he saw this big lump of metal laying on the thing and he picked it up. There was a sock of a plough, D. Patton Monaghan stamped on it. D. Patton Monaghan.
Patton had spread his wings a bit. He was selling ploughs in front.
There was a room downstairs and a very big kitchen, and a room to the back. And there was a very big bedroom upstairs with three beds in it, three double beds. And then there was a wee back room with two double beds in it. And the boys slept in one room. And I slept at the top of the stairs, just as you come in and up the stairs. And I slept there. And I fell down the stairs once.
You did not.
I did indeed. Fell down and they thought I was killed, but it was hard to kill a bad thing.
The Red Row, you had James McBride.
Yeah.
Willie Dorn.
Yeah.
Charlie Collum.
Yeah.
Frank Begley.
Yeah.
Jim Sweeney.
Yeah.
And Charlie Finn. Is it? Sean Finn's father. You know Sean and Amy Vare? Sean's father. Sean was born in that house across the way there.
There was a bigger house on a raised ground between the mill and the White Row, which was built for the manager of the shoe factory. This house was demolished about 30 years ago, in 1883, and a bungalow was built on its site. Another row of houses is attached to Corley's, the house built for the owner of the flax mill. The post office, a shop, and possibly a licensed premises were located here.
And then the other wee row behind old McKenna's.
There was Andy McKenna living in the corner house, and old McKenna, John Gormley, and Rose McGee up at the corner, on the top of the house, above the shop.
At the south end of the Red Row is a larger two-storey premises facing onto the main street, unlike the other houses in the row. This was the lodging house.
The big house that time?
Well, there was six or seven fellas that worked in the factory, and that a wee fella by the name of Joe White used to cook for them.
It was sort of a lodging house.
It was always called the lodging house, you know. Right. It's always known as the lodging house. There was a couple of guys from Belfast, the two dairies from Nuckatallan, a couple of guys from Rockcurry. They all stopped there from Sunday night to Friday evening, and they go home for the weekend, get the clothes washed and come back again.
Come back Sunday evening.
Come back Sunday evening again.
Further south is the felt, known as such because of its felt roof, a building which consists of two houses and formerly four houses. Beside this is Mullan Mills Hall. The village of Mullan was built to house the workers of the flax mill in the 19th century. The mill was possibly built by a Mr. Bullock from Belfast. The village thrived until the turn of the century, when the mill was closed and the village became deserted. In 1925, Master O'Hanlon, J.P. the Boss McKenna, O'Rourke, a coal man from Inniskeen in South County Monaghan, and Charles McCluskey reopened the mill as the county's first boot factory, known as Mullan Mills Shoe Company, and employed 80 people.
It would have been the linen mill the time that they bought it. They bought it from Pringle, the man, the farm across the way there. And when the linen mills closed here, he started the flax mills. So he was scutching flax down here. So he would have owned the village at that particular time.
The houses in the village were, according to an ex-resident of the village, in a bad state of repair and had to be refurbished and renovated for the factory workers and their families at a cost of £8,500 in 1927. The village was alive with hustle and bustle during this time and even had street lights in 1925, powered by the mill race, which powered the factory during the day.
We've seen a lot of changes in our time, didn't we, Phil?
We did, yeah.
The ESB was a great thing now.
It was a big thing to get.
The switch just beside candles and lighting a lamp and putting oil in the lamp and cleaning the wick if a double burner lamp. It was two wicks in a double burner. And then things had to be done while it was daylight.
The factory closed again in 1938. And opened under new ownership in 1944. While the factory was closed, the majority of the people in the village commuted on a weekly basis to Belfast, Five Mile Town, and other places. Mullan Village was only half a mile from the main Belfast to Inniskillen Road, and at the time, two buses were filled every weekend with workers buying Emmy Vale Road returns. In 1944, the factory and the village was purchased for a few thousand pounds from the Irish government by James Boylan, and once again the village thrived as the workers had no need to commute anymore.
I remember when the electricity came to Mullan, it's when Boylan took over the factory.
Yes.
They got the electricity down there, and it was a great thing. The wee village had all got electric in, and it was marvellous.
Mullan Mill has been home to a large number of employees over the years. It was at the time a privilege to obtain employment in the mill.
To get a job here at that time was it? Like a job in a bank or something like that, you know? It was a luxury job at that time. I left school and I worked in a quarry for Ahi Brothers in Tidavnet, and it's the winter time, and I was in muck and water and cold in the winter time, and my father was giving out about this, and it's him got me luck to get me in here. He used to say you could go to your work in your good clothes, which is near enough right at that time.
So after your first day, would you said, I'm going to stay here?
Oh, I loved it. I couldn't believe it. But come here, and the music that time playing over the speakers.
Right.
And you couldn't believe it. You'd be walking in music. Nowadays, you'd hardly even be allowed. But there was music playing over the speakers and all. Okay. And the kind of music I liked even at the time, you know. There's a waiting list at that stage, hundreds. But if there's somebody here walking belonging to you, and if they're a Midland walker, or the third middle of them, you had a better chance of getting in.
Yes, yes.
Somebody's speaking for you, you know.
A brother of mine was walking here, and he left. And my sister was four women in the closing room, and she went to the manager and got me in his place. So my name never was down.
They had an advertisement in the stand looking for a maintenance fitter. So I wouldn't have had any training or anything like that, but I decided the family were all had a background of working at mechanics and stuff like that, and tractors and all that, so I think the mother made a push me into it.
The day I got word to go to Mullan Mill, I got word to go to McCready's.
Oh, big choice.
So, big choice I had to make. I don't know whether I made the right one or not.
Well, what made you make the choice of Mullan Mill?
Well, it was my mother too. She said Mullan Mill was a better place to walk.
Right.
Better job that time.
Mullan Mill traditionally has been a family-run business, and indeed, over the years, many families earned their living there.
It was Hugh and Mary and TJ worked here. There was four of us earned at the one, roughly around the one time.
Well, Benny worked here, Pat worked here, Tommy worked here, Oney worked here. Seamus worked for a while here too. The whole family here worked here.
The mill saw the start of many a romance, which eventually led to marriage for some of the employees.
What about romance in the factory? Had you any romance in the factory?
Well, that's where I met the wife.
Very good, okay. Tell us more.
Well, she used to work in the closing room. And that's... I carried on from that. And we're still together.
I met my wife here, right enough.
Right.
I think there was a scheme that time that was maybe an ANCO or a type of a system or a scheme where people are in... they come out of school for so many weeks. And Geraldine McCarron, she was here, and she'd been back and forward giving messages, you know, and we'd have been maybe sorting invoices, you know, and they would have come in there to check out invoices. Did you buy this or did you buy that, you know? And Geraldine started coming in fairly often, you know, with these invoices, maybe they'd get them done before, you know.
Right.
But that's how we met, and still together since.
Okay, so the romance. You met Victor here?
I did.
Okay. So you were in the office. What was his position here?
Victor was a mechanic. He worked up in the workshop up here. There's a big window looking down on the yard, and himself and Gay Murphy were the two rogues who worked up there, and they had great old times, the pair of them, because there was nobody really over them. They were their own bosses, so they had the crack here now. And that's where I met Victor here.
No, but he walked into the office, did he not?
Well, if there was anything broken in the office, we'd have sent for Victor, yes.
I was in a bit of a different tradition, because we keep them going back and forward, you know, and maybe another year who maybe was trying to draw my attention maybe to the machine, give me more trouble, you know, than the other. I didn't get sidetracked, I didn't stay with the one.
If you went out, if any of the office girls went out around the factory floor, there was usually a lot of wolf whistling and all that sort of thing, so we didn't like going out around the floor at all. We maybe crossed the yard here up to the closing room, but we didn't really like to go down through the factory much.
Paddy Connolly used to stay with Agnes, and Alice didn't live too far away. So that's how they got together.
That happened. Met Alice here through living partly in the factory and partly to where I stayed with Agnes and Jimmy McKenna in Ballinahone. And she was the neighbour. She was the wee lassie that used to come to the well for the water. And we met at the well. So Christ wasn't the only man to meet a woman at the well.
You had romance here too, I know, Vince.
Yeah.
Myra.
She worked in the office. She's on that DVD now. She's stuck out. Weights packets on the table before and in front of her there. When I started in the dispatch, I could make a lot of excuses to get to the office. Myra's working at that time.
Where did Dimpna work in the factory?
She were up in the office with Geraldine, I think, as well for a while.
Okay, give me a quick briefing now just of that whole romance.
So what's still it?
Well, in a factory, was there notes passed between the office? Like, I'm just taking you back here to when you worked up at the end of the last. And was there notes passed, or how did a romance fare out, even in your era compared to the Alice and Paddy's era?
Well, so what's the difference? What era you're in now? As far as I'm concerned, it's all the same. I don't think there's one bit of difference.
Life didn't always run smoothly at the mill. There was always something to keep the maintenance team busy.
There was always pressure to get a machine going, and you had to take if you hadn't got a part, you had to get a part in quick or try and do something with it or get it going. And they called you over the loudspeaker, you know, the sewing room, they would report a fault. They'd bring everybody to the main office, and they would issue in the loudspeaker, would Victor please go to the closing room? You'd go to the machine and you mightn't be fit to pick it up at all, you mightn't be fit to fix it at all, or you might see, you couldn't see what was wrong with it. And you just go and you let on, you walked at it, and you're doing a bit of work, and you said, I got the problem, I said, now, you know, and they'd sit down and you'd come back to them and they'd say, well, that's a great job. And you never done that, it was just mind over matter, you know.
Victor says whenever you come down, you wouldn't do nothing at her, and the next thing the machine was away, you see, so we're a sort of miracle men. Talking about the maintenance man there used to be a fellow walked here, he was a Mickey Fitzpatrick. He was from Mullan, you know, he come after these fellas here. And he was walking John James Daly again. Now he was walking on the seat laster, you know. Well, the seat laster was give plenty of trouble, you know, that time with tax and one thing or another. But John James was in the walk was piling up on the track, you see, with a track that time. And yeah, every man was pushing the stuff up to John James, and he was getting into bad humour anyway. And Mickey Fitzpatrick, I was the foreman that time, so it was very hard to get Mickey down to do anything sort of thing, you know. But he came down anyway, you see, and John James, he was cursing, well, where is this? Mickey Fitzpatrick looking up at the machine, he was thinking, he'd blast himself, you know. Do something with it. And then the next thing he says, an omnipot or something. That made Daly worse than ever he was. He went away and left her the same as, you know, it was impossible to fix her. Like, you could get her going with Midland, but
work in the factory had a dangerous element to it, with all the hazardous materials and dangerous machinery, and the fact that the mill was so close to the river.
The mine had been flooded out a couple of times here with backwater. You know, the place was covered with water, and John McVeigh was the caretaker here, and he'd come up round and would come down and move shoes and boots and stuff to up higher, you know, which was dangerous because it was all electric that time, electric motors. But there's no word of danger.
So whenever I worked here, it's just the socking machine would have been, you know, you all knew the socking machine for putting in the insole. Mm-hmm. They always said then any woman or girl that went to work on the socking machine got pregnant. So was there any machine or anything that, not say now for men, but you know, anything that you wanted, any machine you wanted to avoid or anything in the factory that you never...
That wasn't the machine's fault, but...
Obviously not. But there was an omen to it. Thankfully, I was exempt from that.
I don't think.
I remember Barney Tracy. He was in the making room. And I remember him shouting, "Oh, I'm quick." And I ran over, and his finger had been caught, and the half of this part of the finger was sitting in the machine. And I'll never forget it. And me roaring, somebody come quick. So they had to release the whole machine. Wee Frank McKenna.
Abala.
And he had to come and switch off the machine to release it. And someone shouted at me, would you bring over the finger? I nearly died. I'd never forget that. Same with the brushing machine. My sister lost all her teeth. The brush machine, when we were working at the start, they had a brush machine. You might remember it. You had to brush the shoe, give the shoe an odd brush to be rough with the solution. And there was no guard on it. And she went over and the shoe had still got the last in it. So the brush machine sucked it in, flew it back out, broke all her teeth.
Gosh, so that's... Yeah, there was
she
plenty.
Lost all her teeth at the... That, remember that very bad accident. There was a few fingers, tops of fingers lost and stuff like that.
And obviously probably in the machinists.
And the only place you went to was the doctor. That was, you know, just up to MEVL.
Acetone was kept over here, you know, across there. And it was the winter time, you know. And he went out for a
5 gallon drum with this acetone that he used for dipping the toes in. And that time it was in a big bar, and he had to open it with, a little bung. He had to open it with that. But when he was putting the bung back, the bung came out on him, you see. So he happened to have a match with him, and he stuck the match for to see where the bung was. And it was worse than petrol, you see. It went up.
That's right. Up she went.
He got four, and his two arms was burned, and it was no joke. Like, but that particular evening, we were at the bench, you see, and he was a Mr. Smithson was the manager at that time, an Englishman. And John James come running up the floor in there, and first time I've ever seen him running, you know. he says, the shade's on fire. The Smithson looked at him, the shade's on fire. He had to say it twice because he was an Englishman. What? Listen, says, what? And every man out across the yard.
Somebody killed at the mill wheel one time.
That's my father. Yeah. 1944. Just as soon as the factory opened here again. Yeah, killed down there where the turbine used to be and where the big flywheel used to be in there. Remember there's big flywheels on one side and the turbine was down. One Friday night after the factory closed it for the weekend, those machines broken down and the mechanic was down working at them.
Mm-hmm.
My father went down to switch the power on from put the turbines on.
Flipped and fell.
Going to just knock it off again.
According to some, conditions in the factory were not up to the standards as factories nowadays.
What did you think in your first couple of hours? Think, God, this is not a bad job, or?
This is a terrible job.
Did you?
Standing all day and frozen, very, very cold. And there wasn't anywhere to make tea or anything like that. We used to have to come up the village to a lady, Mrs. Connolly, Kathleen Connolly, and she'd make a cup of tea.
Because I remember whenever I came into Mullan Mill, Molly Coton, Lord of Mercy, or she was there, and it was Molly Coton that trained me in. And I remember walking in, and I just remember the smell of the place was just
terrible.
Stinking. Now, I had come from being a hairdresser,
yeah,
you know, into nice atmosphere, heat and all that, into Mullan Mill. But at the same time, I remember Molly was so comforting and so good. Like, I mean, she handed me a pair of rubber gloves, and I remember thinking, if I had to wear these all day, and then the black wash, of course.
Oh,
and that would be my memories of Mullan Mill as well, would be that my nails were never clean.
No,
my fingers
no.
were always dirty. Yeah. I used to wear the gloves. That the
big long gloves.
Yeah, that they use for calving cows.
Yeah.
Every time I put them on, I had nothing to do with that. But, you know, just always, you know, nearly disgusted putting this big long glove on. You put into and then you put into the sprayer.
The first day I got them, I didn't know how am I going to work this army boot. I remember Brian McKenna. And he said, oh, hold on, I have a pair of gloves for you. And he came down the stairs with the big, big gloves. He says, there you go, when you're finished doing them boots, you can go out to the field and see if the cow ready for calf.
One of the other memories from the office was there used to be an awful lot of rats here because it was beside the river, and Paddy Gavala was the caretaker, and he'd put down the poison when he'd see a rat, and the rats always seemed to come in under the office floorboards and die, and after a few days we'd get this awful smell and we'd vacate the office then, and Patrick would come and start lifting the floorboards and he'd be calling us in and be standing with this big dead rotten rat calling us in. No, this is what's causing the smell. Come on back in, girls. You're all right. It's dead.
I remember a smell in the office one time, but they said it was rats coming out of the river to die under the floorboards, and it was horrendous. So it was.
Well, all I could say is the young ones wouldn't do work in them conditions now, you know. Not with the cold, you know. Like the cold.
Well, then what else would you say?
Well, then in the summertime you had the heat. All the doors about the place would be open, but you'd still be mad warm, you know. Like.
Although working conditions in the factory were tough, people still found time to have some fun and a laugh.
It used to be a fat man here, Packy McKenna, Packy Rowe, we called him. Packy's a real character, like he's always had some badness. John James talked about taxi here, but Packy used to get us, some of us walking through the making room, and he'd get a handful of taxi and he'd fire them at you. And they'd be into your hair and down the back of your shirt. And you'd look around and Packy'd been walking away, you wouldn't know he'd done, but one time, Anna, Packy, every evening at quitting time, him and the son, Brian, and Mary, the daughter, the three of them was here at one stage. They'd be forced in the morning and forced out at night, in the evenings, running much to the car. So I remember myself and Jared McConn, fallen in my veil, but decided would block him in. So Packy at dinner time, it was always back fairly early, packed his chair. So we drove our two chairs up tight, one each side that he couldn't get in, locked our chairs up, and when it come quitting time, man, packy out, couldn't get into the chair, started a whole shouting match in the yard. And young Jim Byrne was here that day, actually. And I think he came out, and he ran over to him, and he laughed at it.
The day I started, I was sent by one of the workers. It was a man came down into his room and didn't know very many people. And he said, would you go up to the cutting room and get me a glass hammer? And I said, God, where do I go? And he said, up that door there and just go in and you'd see a fella called James Kearney, ask him for the glass hammer. And of course I went in and I asked James Kearney, this man want to lend the glass hammer? And he said, God, I'm sorry, I haven't got it. You'll have to go on up to the other room. And they sent me up to the closing room. And it was Annie Kelly in the closing room. And I went up and said, Miss Kelly, I landed the glass hammer. And she said, God, you'll have to go down to the cutting room, the clicking room. Where I said, I've been there, I think. He says, well, you know you'll get it. You'll get it in the making room. So she sent me straight back to the man that sent me the glass. Then I realised that they were playing a complete prank on me. Yeah. Glass hammer.
Bishop was coming down on the big opening day for this, and I got the job of building the altar for the bishop to say the mass. And I made the warning to build a good, strong platform because the bishop was a very heavy man. And I'd done that, but he blessed the whole place off to say the mass. But that evening, Pikey went up this ladder, Pikey Row again, up the ladder to put a belt on the machine, which he shouldn't have done really. And he was through off the ladder and was hospitalised. And he said, if that old bishop had to say rewards, we'd be no need of trouble.
The lunchtime bell was the highlight of the day for many. It meant that employees had an hour to go home and do their own thing. But there were repercussions if they weren't back in time.
At that time, the dinner time was an hour. So we landed back here, should be back at 2 o'clock. We landed back about 2:15. And there was a man here, Smithson, was the manager. So he saw us, or somebody saw us coming in late. So we landed over and sacked the three of us.
For how long?
It is me and Jimmy Coat, and a fellow called Jimmy Coat and Mimi Vale, and it's Seamus McQuaid by from Glasgow as well, a far out friend of my own. So Jimmy Coat, he told us to get home and never come back, or something like that. So Jimmy Coat, he went out and went home, and we didn't go home, I don't know why. Went back over and walked away. So the other boy went home, and he was at home for a week or so. And then this McQuaid fellow, me, went to Smithson. He would tackle him in the office one day, but get another boy back. And he says, I never told him to leave. But he actually did, but he'd flare up and he didn't mean it, you know.
Right.
So he got back.
You're sure to meet a foreman coming in the yard. God, where were you at the shop? What kept you? Oh, there's so many there. I just never knew many people to be in all shop me life. Was his answer. I said, well, there was three or four people before me.
Caretaker here, he used to, if you weren't down here at 8 o'clock, that gate would be closed and you'd have to sit there for 15 minutes and you were docked for 15 minutes.
As in every employment, there were conflicts of interest between management and the employees.
At one time there was a strike about wages, Pat, and we're all out on the road. We stayed out for 3 days.
Jim McQuaid is playing the accordion.
That's right.
Yeah.
Some of them would have waited on a cloud to get their hair cut and others would have waited at home.
We had to come back on a Monday morning and meet Mr. Boylan, and everybody was interviewed individually. It was on strike. The first man he lit on was Paddy Rowe, Paddy McKenna. And he says, aye, Paddy, and you were out too. I was indeed, Mr. Boylan, and I went in the morning again. Paddy says, oh, I know, he says, you were always an old fool, and haven't you? I was always right, but Mr. Boylan, I was always right. But then Jim McQuaid was the next man he lit on. And he says, I want to see you in the office. You know, and Jim had to go around to the boardroom that time, and the next thing Jim was gone, sacked on the spot. So then the word spread through, and at dinner time we all decided we'd go out again, you see. And we were in the entry anyway, we weren't going back into the room, and the old boy came across here from the office and up and into the entry. And he gave out to everybody, you see. And I looked round me, and the next thing there was nobody left, only myself, you see. And I says to him, I say, Mr. Wells, you sacked him because you done wrong, you know. He says, look, young fella, he says, don't you tell me how to do my job. He says, you have a job here. If you want it, go into it. And if you don't want it, go out through the gate. So that was it. Jim McQuaid left after, I don't know how many years he was here, all his life nearly.
So you went back to your work?
Went back to my work very quietly.
Bonnie there. Bonnie's walking a lot, you know, violating the boss came in and tackled him about something not been done. Bonnie says, I haven't time to do it. I'm doing the work, he says, of three men here. But Bonnie says, get me the name of the other two and I'll sack them.
That's right.
Like, you know, used to be talked to the boardroom about not doing enough of work, and he'd said, oh, well, you have a lot of white coats around you, but they're not much good to you.
Paggy Savage was a funny fella. He was a real comedian, you know, like, he was a very quick-witted man. I mean, one day it was Joe Corrigan was there, you know, but Smithson would come down with samples to our bench, you know, and he'd do them himself, like, but we had to put the toes and stuff in and tack them on and all, you know. But he told Joe something, I mean, Joe didn't hear him, you see, he was hard to understand with the noise and all, you know. So Joe run sort of down after him, down. Smithson would walk, when he started, he'd two or three spines, he'd be down, you know, rugby player. And he'd be down at the bottom of the room, you know. And Joe was coming with his pair upwards in his hand, you see, and shouting and shouting. And Smithson heard him all right, but he kept going on, you see. And he went on down to the bottom of the thing. And he says to Joe, he says, I'm not a bloody dog, he says, you know, I'm not a bloody dog. So Joe said something to him, go back to your work, go back to your work. And Joe was coming back up past Paddy Savage, you know, and Paddy says to him, is you and Smithson going out for a hunt?
But why did you walk out, Coach?
I just walked out because the foreman was over that time, wasn't, me and him wasn't agreeing.
You didn't agree with
this decision? We met the manager in the door there in the entry, and he asked me where I was going. I said, I'm going back in to work. I thought you left here, he says. I said, so it is. Well, get back in and work, he says.
Oh, why did you come back?
Mother left me in the back. Yeah, I nearly got killed that evening when I went home.
When I came back, the first word was said to me, oh, here comes an old last lock woman again.
Who said that?
Not going to tell you.
Oh, go on, Anne. It wasn't me.
No.
For I didn't know you. Well, I didn't know you.
I had to approach you and you said, I said, we don't do the army that way. You and I had a bit of a fight. Do you not remember that?
Certainly do not. That's great. I do not remember that.
You said, well, this is the way we're doing them now. And I said, no, well, it can't be because that wouldn't be right.
And how long would I have been there to have that authority?
Oh, well, you had that authority when I went.
So there you go.
Brian McKenna came down and separated the purpose. And Johnny Bond said, Magella and been doing army from 1966. So you give her whatever she says.
Even the small issue of trying to get the day off for a wedding or a funeral proved difficult at times.
It used to be a funeral, if it was an uncle or a... You'd take off and go to the funeral, but he made a law, unless it's somebody like your mother or a father or a brother or a sister, you get off the morning of the funeral, the day of the funeral just for it.
Mm.
And if it was an uncle, you didn't get off.
Did anybody break that?
I did. And if it was a wedding, the same thing applied to a wedding.
Oh.
You wouldn't get off to a wedding unless you're own. And I think maybe your brother or sister. But after that, you didn't get off.
Most of the weddings have been on holiday time, you know, in August. Or...
Right.
There was no, you wouldn't let you off for getting married that time. Couldn't do without you.
Without you.
I remember one year I had three collections here for a wedding.
I'll never get married.
Today did the finish up. Yeah. I'll not mention the name. It has been off three times. And I don't know where to get back to or what. You probably know who I'm talking about, James. But I'll not say it in there.
Down through the years, salaries varied, and oftentimes employees felt that they should have been getting more than they were.
You're talking about James Boyle now. This is the man, yeah. Well, I mind us going around looking for a raise here. The whole lasting department and the making, not all the making room now, you know, but we went around here and we looked for a race. Paddy McKenna was there, Row, we called him. And there was Podge and there was a whole lot of, you know. And we went round anyway and went down on that, sitting in the boardroom. This is where, and Mr. Bylan came in and asked us what was wrong, you see. So every man, there was nobody spoke, you see. But Paddy Rose says, we want a raise, Mr. Bylan. You know, we're looking for. Paddy says, you have too much money. He says, you don't want a raise, you know. That old crack's no good to me, he says, I'm only getting so much here. And go down to Gillespie's down across the border, he says, and I'm getting 50 bob a day for Gann's foot. Don't you talk about the money you're giving here, he says. Everybody started to laugh, you know, like you couldn't help it. But that's the way it ended up. We got no raise.
No raise.
Oh. Well, every man went out to the door laughing. You wouldn't even talk, do you? That was it. That time we were working from 9 to 5. That was the hours. And I started off with 19 shillings a week.
Right.
And I paid 21 shillings for my dinner and tea in McQuaid's up the street. So I was actually out money. That time you had a, when you started here, you had to work on a very small wage for for a long time, you know.
And you just accepted it?
That was the way it was. If you weren't happy with it, you could go home. Yeah. And that's, they tell you that. There was Mr. Smithson here. Which, if you're not happy here, there's the gate, you know.
First time a week, I got a pound from Wicks Bay.
Okay, then moving on, you were in that job a good length.
After 6 months, I got another 5 shillings.
That wasn't too bad, 6 months review, so roughly every 6 months it was.
I started to come up every 6 months.
Well, I started off the same with Gavin, the pound a week. 17 and 8 pence when the stamp was taken out of it.
Right, so when you got promoted then, do you remember that?
I got a half crown, the first raise I got was a half crown, to leave me with a pound clear.
Okay.
I think that put me 2 pence over the pound.
I think it was 30 shillings for the first year or something like that. And then you got a raise after that.
I was working in Ahi's thing, and I got £3 a week. And £3 a week that time was seemed to be a lot of money, you know. Mm-hmm. And I come here, and I got £2.50. I cut a 50p.
I was going to say you were down.
Or 50, whatever it was at the time. I was down money, yeah.
But you loved the job.
I loved the job, yeah.
I started at £7. And that was good money for me. And I finished at 9.
When I left here in 1970, I had 5 of a family. I was taking home £14 a week.
The money was better than what G&M shoes were paying too.
So what was the money?
It was £22.50 a week that time.
Punt.
Right.
It's £100 a week. And I remember coming off the phone and saying to Mommy, my God, I'm getting £100 a week.
Right,
you know, it was like big money. Then I was only coming from a job at 60.
I'll tell you what I've done. It reared a family. No matter how much you had, like you, nobody else had any more than you. Because you were working the same hours as the rest of them. And still, you went home on a Friday evening. Like, you had your wages there and you'd lock a pound left for, you might have only maybe a pound left for the rest of the week. Mm-hmm. But it's still done you, you know.
The reasons for the desertion of Mullan are complex and interlinked. One of the reasons was undoubtedly the rise of the Troubles in Northern Ireland and the proximity of the village to the border. The people of Mullan also had close links with their Northern Irish neighbours, socially and commercially, and the destruction of Ballabridge, which linked the village to its natural hinterland, resulted in Mullan's relative isolation.
It was a great road for smuggling cattle, this.
Was it?
Oh, it was great. It used to be like the Wild West here at night. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I remember going down there, 3 lorries parked side by side at the factory. And maybe with the ramps down. About 40 head of cattle coming up the road and run them right up the ramps into the 3 lorries, closed them, took them away, brought them down around 2:00 the next day and got the headage on them and took them back this way the next night.
Any time we went down that way smuggling, Oh, steady. Sure, we got the white bread down there, didn't we?
Exactly.
And tea.
You couldn't.
And Clark's.
Clark's. And the bread was rationed.
It was.
But you could go to Clark's and get a loaf in it.
That's right.
You got
a white
the
loaf.
Uh-huh.
There was no sliced bread then.
No. There was no such a thing as a sliced pan then.
No.
They had no knives.
They used to pluck the bread. Coming home, I mind my brothers, they'd have it plucked, a loaf.
Yeah, you'd have half of it
take
eaten.
A bit and
right.
Take a bit.
And you'd have the bread eaten without
oh, pork. Oh, it was good sauce, you know.
That's why we're so fat.
Dry bread.
You'd be afraid going down to Clark.
You'd be searched. Uh-huh. You could be searched.
You'd be searched. Once you'd go over by the bridge.
They told a yarn about these two women, and one had smuggled tea, dry tea, and it was a quarter pound or something, because it was rationed on our side. And she had it in here somewhere, the tea, and there was sugar, I think. The other woman must have had sugar, I don't know. But one woman says to her, you have the sugar, I have the tea wet.
What are you saying, Tessa?
It's very good.
At the start of the 1970s, several new housing schemes in Monaghan and Emmy Vale meant that a lot of the younger population left to avail of the more modern housing. This probably contributed substantially to the decline of the village, as there was no young families living in the area anymore. By now, only three houses in the village were inhabited. Mullan's border location contributed greatly to its decline over the past quarter of a century, and the village suffered a gradual reduction of population, with most of the mill houses falling into disrepair and abandonment by the 1990s. In 2002, Michael Trainer, a local businessman, purchased the village, and gradually began to restore the mill houses and revive the village as a centre for the local community once more. The story of the restoration of the village featured on the RTE Nationwide programme in 2007.
This evening we're coming to you from the tiny village of Mullan in County Monaghan, a village that we in Nationwide visited 7 years ago when it was near derelict and up for sale. At the time, there were worries that the character of the village would be ruined and that many of the houses and cottages knocked down. As you can see today, that hasn't happened. The village is in the process of being rebuilt. And Niall Martin brings us a report now on how the Celtic Tiger finally came to Mullan.
When the postman calls to Mullan, it's a short stop. There are just two residents in this tiny village close to the border.
We're only left now with Seamus here in the house behind me here, and the post office, and James Trainer that lives up the lane onto the side of me here as well. So basically there was very little stops to be made in the village.
7 years ago the village was put up for sale, lock, stock and water pump. For the price of a four-bed detached house in Dublin, you could have the whole of Mullan. Despite rumours of American interest, it was a local developer who bought it.
Well, it was £500,000. It was just shortly before the euro came in, and there's a huge investment after that for to restore the houses. Obviously, in terms of Dublin prices, Mullan looked cheap, but this is never going to be in Dublin. It'll always be Mullan Village, you know. All the houses were derelict, apart from the one where Seamus Mulligan lives at the top of the village. Every other house was in various states of dereliction. Some of them completely, almost beyond repair, you would think, but we have managed to conserve all the houses.
You have to pump it away before the water comes, you know what I mean?
And with the village water pump and the new solar-panelled houses standing side by side, Jimmy Trainer, the older of Mullan's two residents, is looking forward to a time when the village will once again field its own football team.
I know the man, he lived down in the corner house down there. He's dead now, well near there. And he could kick a ball from that corner up onto that hill. We couldn't get a man now to kick a ball from here to there.
And what about if there were new children around here, kicking ball around here? Would you mind, or would you welcome them in?
Oh, we welcome, surely. But I'd have to start, go back and start the old football again.
This Christmas, Mullan's lights will begin to glow again as the village experiences a 21st century reincarnation.
And we look forward to the Mullan team winning the county championships, perhaps, in the years to come.
What encouraged you to buy the village, Mickey?
I suppose it was madness. Actually, it was the factory, really. I was after the factory for space for young business in Monaghan. Thought I'd buy it and see what happened then after that. It was always my idea then to do the houses up and try and make them habitable again. So we're still in the process. The last building we've worked on, we're still working on just what used to be the old village hall, but I haven't got a plan for it yet. So anybody has ideas for that one, come and tell me. It'd be nice to see life in the village again. And the summer's evening here would be great when the children's all out playing on the green. That'd be nice to see that, there's a great buzz about the place. It's just good to see it coming back. It was derelict for long enough.
You have brought the industry back to the factory. Can you tell us a little bit about what work goes on there now?
Well, it's Mike that's looking after that business and Adele. We're making light fittings in the factory. Fittings for churches and chapels and pubs and hotels and restaurants, that sort of stuff. So the stuff that's not just the off-the-shelf type of thing. And it's going right well. Most of what we're producing is being exported. Maybe if the Ireland was a wee bit different economy-wise, you could sell more in Ireland, but for the moment, the most of what we're producing there is exporting, and it's going pretty good, and it's improving. It's building year on year there. I think it'll be a success in the longer term, all right. It's going right well for them now.
You've started maybe to let out some areas for other businesses to come into the village. There's a pottery.
Aye, Brenda McGinn, Busy Bee Pottery, she trades us. And she has taken a small bit of space down at the factory as well. And she seems to be doing nicely there too. We'd be delighted to make space for more businesses if more businesses want space. If we can at all, we'd love to accommodate them. It'd be great to see more people working in the village and more people doing business in the village. We'd be delighted to try and accommodate that if we could.
Do you feel that the village has returned to form now that the factory workers are now living in the village again?
Aye, to a fair extent it has. Well, to a certain extent it has, yeah. In some respects, of course, the village is better than it was, and that the accommodation here is better than what was here when the people lived in it before. Which, one of the main reasons that people left the village was they got offered better housing, that had services in the houses, running water, etc. So that has been the sole services in any house now. So in some respects, the village is better than it was. In some respects, well, there's elements of it yet to be completed.
I never thought I would live to see anybody coming and doing what Mickey has done to this place. And to do it in such style, the way it's done up, you know. I've seen repairs being done here on and off down the years, but there's only patching this and patching that, you know. Big undertaking to think with this mantle gone. There's not very many men in the country with a chance at the time.
When I've moved
should become a stranger, know that it would make me more than sad. Caledonia has been everything I've ever had.
In August 2012, Truagh Development Association organised a hugely successful day entitled Celebrating Truagh's Heritage.
There's going to be a celebration down at Mullan Mill.
Oh, is it?
Hmm.
And we're invited, haven't we?
We're invited. Good. Especially guests.
The two of us.
The two of us.
No, Tessie, we'd have to get dressed up for that.
Over 500 people came to visit the historic Mullan village on the day, and were entertained by a host of activities, including traditional handcrafts by local artists, heritage display, children's games, vintage car display, and village and factory tours.
When you don't need to worry, there'll be days like this. When no one's in a hurry, there'll be days like this. When you don't get betrayed by that old Judas kiss. Oh, my mama told me there'll be days like this. When you don't need an answer, there'll be days like this. When you don't need a chance, there'll be days like this. When all the parts of the puzzle start to look like they fit, then I must remember there'll be days like this. Playing tricks it. When you don't have no freeloaders out there, get their kicks it. Well, that's nobody's business the way that you want to live. I just have to remember there'll be days like this. When no one steps on my dreams, there'll be days like this. When people understand what I mean, there'll be days like this. When you ring out the changes of how everything is, well, my mama told me, yeah, there'll be days.
A highlight for many was the reminiscing discussion hosted by Magella Connolly, where past residents and employees of Mullan Mills looked back fondly at their memories of living and working in Mullan.
Hello, everyone. And you're all very welcome here today, this commemoration and memory day of Mullan Mill. Now, my end of Mullan Mill is in the later years, so that's why we're in this marquee, because I see a lot of faces maybe that can tell more stories. In fact, I know can tell more stories than I can tell.
Very good memories. But then when Peter came, I couldn't get out of it quick enough.
When I come to Mullan Mill here, there was well over 100 people working at it. And it was a little community, it was a village. It had all the things that a village would have. It had a shop, it had a hall, and it had people, great people. a great community.
Sean McEntee was the secretary, and anyone that worked under Sean McEntee could go anywhere. He was the best secretary in Ireland, so I'd like to pay tribute to him.
And I'd like to pay tribute to the people that we all worked with in them days. Many of them are gone to rest. They were great people. It was a great community. Everybody's very happy. There was no begrudgery. The people come happy to their work, and they left, and they worked half days on Saturday, all this type of thing. But that's the type of Ireland we had at the time. And we've changed, but it's good to have those. This is the day about memories, and those memories will be treasured.
Give me a few names of the ladies that worked with you in the closing room at that time.
Well, Veronica McNeil would have been one of them. Red Lahorn would have been my best friend sitting beside me. Mary Kelly, Darna Hutton would have been another girl, yeah. Rose McGee was the forewoman when I started in at first. And then Kathleen McQuaid, Mullan Mill here, she came next. And then Sadie McQuaid of Darna Hutton was one of my forewomen too.
You worked in what end of Mullan Mill?
I worked over in the office, downstairs in the office.
With a couple of girls that worked in the office that time?
Mary McQuaid, you know Mary Kirk, she's Kirk now, Mary was there, and Breed McIsmick, Breed McKenna, who has passed away. Maria Neeson was there, Olive McKenna, she's married to Philip Feather, Olive was there at the time. Dimna Finnegan was there, and she met Brian here.
A letter from Jackie Kerr to be read out if it was all possible, you know. So I'll just read out the letter that he wrote. Right. It is too bad that the 1930 children cannot be with you to join in the celebrations that are taking place in the village on August the 19th, 2012. Most of them have gone to their final reward. However, if you look down to the end of the red row, sometime during the festivities, you will see all in spirit gathering at McBride's Corner, admiring what Mr. Trainer has done and will do for our village. He took on an enormous task and succeeded where others were not willing to go. I would love to meet him and shake his hand, not once, but 1,000 times, and thank him on behalf of the 1930s children and all the ones that come after, and also the ones that went before. They also walked, raced and played in the same street and lived in the same houses. Let us give a round of applause for Michael Trainer for what he has accomplished so far and what he will accomplish in the future. To the village we all love and love so much. God bless Michael. Jackie Carr. Jackie, you live in the
Jackie. We'd come down here nearly for 6 weeks every year to spend our time around Mullan. And we'd watch all the bicycles going up and down, and we'd come down and see them playing handball here on the end. And
well, I was a very young girl. I just left school and I started here. Like, I started in 1975. I was only two at the time.
Father Sean Nolan decided that we maybe set up and get a development done in Mullan Mill. This is what has led to this development now. And that was under the International Fund for Ireland. Some money was going to be available to do the village all up and restore it. But it would go back to the Boylan family again in 14 or 15 years. So it didn't look that attractive when you read the small print, and it stalled at that. And then Michael Trainer come and bought it, and I want to congratulate Michael too on what he has done here to save this from total extinction.
Okay, so Stephen Fuller, can you give me a briefing on him?
Well, he was a big tall Englishman, a fancy English accent. He'd been fairly strict now, I have to say. Some of the workers might have been particularly enamoured with him, but I got on all right to them. He'd done whatever he had to do, and he was, let's say, we kept the place going. Without him, I think Mullan Mill would have probably been gone down the hill quicker than it did, but he tried everything and anything to keep it going. Like, we making belts, we made mountain boots, we made farm boots, you know, he tried to keep the place going. And there was one particular fella working on the track, and he was from Glasdown. I seen him here earlier, Sean Comiskey. He probably won't mind me saying, mention his name, but Sean used to, he'd always be a couple of minutes late every morning. No matter what you tell him, he'd still be there a couple of minutes late, but Sean was a great motorbike man. And he'd arrive in with a full gear on him, leather jacket, leather trousers, leather gloves, helmet, the whole works. But the boss man here, he was Stephen Fuller, he was from England, an Englishman. And he used to come round the factory every morning and he'd speak to everybody and say, good morning, how are you? And you'd say, go back to him, good morning, Mr. Fuller, how are you? And off he went. So this morning he came round on him and I was working on the track and he says, Sean's not in yet. I says, no, he's not in yet, sir, now. So off he went and he went up into the closing room and the cutting room. And he'd always come back that direction, you see. So just as he was coming down out of the closing room, Jesus, who was, I hear the door slamming over on the other side, and who was coming through the door? Only Sean. This was about 8:10. And Sean was coming over the floor. He had a helmet on the one arm and a lunchbox under this. He had the full outfit on him. And Fuller met him straight in the middle of the floor, and he says, good morning, Sean, you're late. And Sean's not that tall, but he was looking up at him, because this man's about 6'2". Sean looked up at him and he says, better Sean Comiskey late than the late Sean Comiskey. I was the last known foreman on the last track this time, and as I said earlier, we had trouble getting up the production for the Levi's for Clark's. But Sean came in this morning anyway, and around about 9:30 he came down to me. I don't know where I was doing, but he says, Brian, he says, I'm looking a day off. And I says, what? A day off? You must be joking. I says, look at the boss man will never let you off. I says, so we have to get this production out every day. I says, no way, Sean, I can't let you off. Well, I says, what do you want anyway? What are you doing? He says, I'm getting married. And I played along. I says, Sean, there's no way. I says, well, when are you getting married? I think he said it was on a Wednesday or Thursday. And I says, can you not get married on a Saturday, like the rest of them? And I played along with him, and I pretended all day that he couldn't get this day off. So we kept coming back to him about two or three times, all different times during the day. I said, I have to talk to the manager. You see, he was Johnny Bond. He lived up on Ballinode. And I says, I can't let you off. I says, but if Johnny Bond's prepared to let you off, I says, that's all right. So he kept coming back to me during the day, and I pretend. I says, no, I hadn't time to talk to him yet. God, would you leave me alone? I says, we're flat out here. But eventually, anyway, I let him go into the next day, and I told him that he could have the day off to get married.
And
I think he did forgive me for that.
And he did get married.
Oh, he did. He got married, and they're still married.
Jimmy, what year did you start working in Mullan Mill?
Well, I didn't work there much altogether. Yeah, that's me. I was here all right, but didn't work.
You're the kind of man we want to talk to.
I was on. It wasn't a machine as such. I was stamping in numbers and shoes and things like that. You know what I mean? It wasn't a machine as such. Like.
Okay, was there any characters in that room?
They were all characters.
Okay, why did you leave Mullan Mill?
I don't know, probably maybe getting too much money here or something. I don't know. Used to play handball out at across the road here. And I don't know. I remember John McVeigh coming down the road with the keys every day for to open up the factory, you know what I mean? After dinner time. And I'd hate to see him coming and tell you the truth. That's the only thing I remember of it.
So can you give me one good memory?
Getting out of it.
At least you're honest. At least you're honest.
All right.
Thank you, Jimmy. Thanks very much.
It's a shame that that was lost. There's a bit of skill in making shoes.
Oh, yes. Yeah.
Yeah? A bit of skill in making shoes. From it started up. In the first big room there, with the round roof, and you made one room. That was the women's clothes room on one side, and the men's cutting room, as they called it, on the other side. Mm. They cut the stuff, and the women sewed it together. Then went downstairs to Barney Kerr's room, as they called it, mm-hmm. and they cut the soles and got them all ready. Then they came over to the making room. Mm-hmm. That's where you're making the lamps now.
Right.
And then they went upstairs to John Connolly's room, and they were finished and boxed and set out.
It's just a pity that it had its lows when it did. It gave good employment in this locality at that particular time. People were glad to have it for to go to.
I did actually enjoy it, I have to honestly say. And every time I go by it, I think, yeah, that was my first job, you know.
Good old days. They were, sure. Uh-huh. no
bare feet.
There was nothing bad
once,
about
once
them.
Once the first of May come, sure the puddles in the road was lovely with your bare feet.
To sum up life in Mullan, we leave the last word to Seamus Mulligan, a man who spent his entire life in the village.
The best little place in the country to live in. I wouldn't live any place else.